Hey everyone, Mr. Ham here to talk to you today about President JFK, but especially his election and assassination. Depending on when you're watching this, you probably know a thing or two about his term in office, some of the things he did. And today we're going to talk about kind of how it began and then how it ended. So JFK gets his start as president with the election of 1960. So President Eisenhower had served for two terms, so he can no longer run. So running as the Republican is Richard Nixon. Nixon is a Republican candidate. He was Eisenhower's VP, so he had been in the presidency for, you know, in the White House for a while. And his whole platform was essentially running on Eisenhower's policies. So whatever Eisenhower's policies were, Nixon was running on those as the common man. He's a guy from small town California. That was what his appeal was trying to be, just the everyday man. Whereas Kennedy was a little bit different. He was the Democratic candidate, and he was a relative newcomer to politics, especially compared to Nixon. Now, he had served in both the House and Senate at this time, but he was a young guy. He was 43 at the time. And his whole platform was on change. So he was looking to change foreign policy, change how the United States behaved, especially with the Soviet Union, and then some of the issues at home, which we are going to get into. So a little bit about JFK. Kennedy was a young and charismatic guy. He was good looking. He was 43, so he was he looked a lot younger than his age, and he would be the youngest president in the United States. He was also a veteran. He had served in the Pacific during World War II, where he had seen action, and he had, in fact, rescued some of his fellow sailors during that combat, so he was also a war hero. JFK was also one of the very first presidents to begin talking about civil rights. We will talk more about the civil rights unit in our next, or the civil rights movement in our next unit, but it's starting to ramp up during this time period. We talked about that Jim Crow era, and it's starting to come to an end. We're starting to have some traction, especially with people like Martin Luther King Jr., who had been jailed during the Eisenhower presidency, and JFK had called for his release, something that Nixon hadn't done, and so that also set him apart. A final defining characteristic of JFK is the fact that he was Catholic. Now, we have a Catholic president right now. Joe Biden is the second Catholic president because JFK was the first. He was someone that was very devout Catholic, and this worried a lot of Americans because there were Americans that felt like, well, maybe Kennedy is going to be more beholden to the Catholic Church than he is to the American people. And so this became a concern, a genuine concern for a lot of people. What do we do if Kennedy becomes president? Would the Pope become involved in American politics? Those were all questions that were kind of, you know, floating around out there as this election is going on. So what actually happens during the election? Well, the election of 1960 is unique because this is the very first election that there are presidential debates televised. So both Kennedy and Nixon were present, and they would be asked questions, they would have a debate and everything like that. And this is groundbreaking. This is the first time that the American people had seen presidential candidates in action debating. And this worked in Kennedy's favor because Kennedy was seen as a young, good-looking guy. He was tan. He had spent a lot of time on the beach. He was very healthy-looking. You know, he's a former soldier, whereas Nixon was a lot older than him. He looked pale and sickly, even though he wasn't necessarily sick, just in comparison to the kind of the young, charismatic, healthy-looking Kennedy, Nixon looked a little pale and, you know, old-fashioned compared to him. So this is definitely a win for Kennedy. The next big part of this are the issues. Like I said, Nixon was running on Eisenhower's platform. And what this ended up doing is it made him feel kind of out of touch with the American people and unwilling to see change. He had said several things that kind of pointed to this. He didn't think that Martin Luther King Jr. should be freed. A lot of things kind of are pointing to this out-of-touchness that Nixon kind of had. Whereas Kennedy was seen as someone that was a supporter to the poor, and he was a proponent of civil rights. He was young and charismatic and energetic, and he was going to fix these issues. Nevertheless, though, this election was the closest in history. It was a very, very narrow election, with Kennedy winning with fewer than 120,000 votes out of the 69 million. So very close election, very hotly debated, but Kennedy wins the election. So that leads us to the Kennedy White House and the Kennedys themselves. Now, Kennedy and his family were known to kind of bring some style to the White House. Like I said, he was a younger guy. He was had a good-looking family, kind of this all-American guy that changed the way people kind of looked at the presidency in several ways that are still in action today. So, for example, they brought a lot of youth to the White House. He and his wife Jacqueline, they brought two children to the White House, and they were constantly in the media, constantly being filmed, constantly being, shown on the media and everything like that. But especially his wife, Jacqueline. The First Lady pretty quickly became a fashion icon and media sensation. She was the First Lady that was very active. She was a very ardent supporter of the arts. She was often seen wearing, some of the latest fashions and styles and everything like that. She was essentially one of the very first, First Lady celebrities, if you want to think of it that way. Someone that is young, very active, very good with the media as well. Just seen as a very, she was a very well-loved figure in the White House, Jacqueline was. Here's some images here. This is Jack Jr. over here on the left in Kennedy's desk as he's working. Of course, this is the Kennedy family over here on the right with some dogs and everything like that. So again, there are thousands of images out there just like this of the Kennedys just being in an all-American family. Which, if you look kind of back at history before this, you have Eisenhower, who was an older white man who had served as president for 8 years, kind of seen as a he was a war general. He was kind of this stodgy old figure. And before him, you have FDR and then Hoover, or excuse me, you have Truman. Then FDR, then Hoover. Again, kind of these older guys that were kind of seen as stodgy and not very, not very charismatic and everything compared to this young Kennedy family. Okay, so again, I want to talk about kind of the beginning. We touched on that and what the Kennedys brought to the White House, and then of course I want to focus on the end of his presidency with his assassination. So. Building support for his re-election, JFK and Jackie travel to Dallas to give a speech. He's looking for support, so he's going to go to Dallas to give a speech, and just make media appearances like presidents do, especially presidents running for re-election. This is 1963 now. So, November 22nd, 1963. This is the date that he is scheduled to give this speech. So at 11:52 a.m., John and Jackie begin traveling in a motorcade to the site of his speech. So this is John and Jackie here in the car, and they are traveling to a luncheon where they're going to give a speech. You can see Jackie in her pink outfit. It's a Chanel jacket and everything. And at 12:30, as they are driving down to this place, their streets are lined with people. There are cameras everywhere. Two shots ring out, both hitting the president. This is an image from the film, from the video, and this is Jackie here. You can see her in her pink outfit. Crawling over the back of this limousine. Just 3 minutes later, at 1 p.m., Kennedy is pronounced dead at Parkland Hospital. And then, an hour and a half after that, the Vice President, Lyndon Johnson, accompanied by Jackie Kennedy here, you can see in this image, is sworn in aboard Air Force One. So, in a matter of 3 hours, you can see from him boarding, getting in this car, to about 2:30, we go from JFK running for re-election, being shot and killed, and then LBJ being sworn in as the President of the United States. Now, again, it's very important. LBJ is being accompanied by Jackie Kennedy. She is wearing the exact same outfit she had been wearing that day. That shows you how quick this is going on. It is a blood-stained outfit. The blood of her husband is still on her as she is accompanying the new President of the United States as he's being sworn in. Okay, so what happened? If you guys have any, inkling about history and things like that, there are a ton of moving parts to the Kennedy assassination. And maybe the most important figure in the Kennedy, probably the most important figure in the Kennedy assassination, aside from Kennedy himself, is Lee Harvey Oswald. Lee Harvey Oswald, he is a former U.S. Marine, so he had served in the Marine Corps, but he had become disillusioned with the United States and had denounced the United States and defected to the Soviet Union. So he had left the United States and joined the Soviet Union. He returns though, and when he learns of Kennedy giving the speech, he plots for the murder of JFK. He was an accomplished rifleman in the Marines, and armed with a rifle, he finds a vantage point in the Texas School Book Depository. It's essentially an abandoned warehouse. Not abandoned, but there aren't people in there right now. And he finds a window in the book depository And as the motorcade is driving by, he fires two shots, killing Kennedy. Now, Oswald is arrested hours later after killing a police officer in an attempt to escape. But it's really interesting. 2 days later, while he's being transferred from that county jail, so they have a county or a city jail, he's being transferred to a county jail, so a more secure location. Oswald is shot and killed by a local nightclub owner. So this is on television. You can go and watch this if you really want to. But Oswald is being escorted. These are all police officers here. And Jack Ruby here, with a handgun, comes and shoots Oswald, killing Oswald. So, you can probably see some problems here. There are major, major questions that arise now based off of this. Why did Oswald do it? Who was behind this? Was it just him? Was he acting alone? You can't question him now because he's gone. So, we'll get back to that. But the funeral of JFK. 250,000 people came to view the president lying in state. So this is Kennedy's casket here. It's an aerial view. Him lying in state at the Capitol Rotunda. This is less than a day's worth. He was lying in state, 21 hours, and 250,000 people came to see the president lying in state. There were representatives from over 100 countries that attended his funeral. So it was obviously a massive geopolitical event here. And this is Jackie Kennedy here in the middle. This is Robert Kennedy, so John's brother, and this is his other brother over here, Ted Kennedy. We'll talk a little bit more about these two men in the coming days. And this is John Jr., his son, saluting his father's casket as it passes. JFK had taught John how to salute because they were planning on doing a visit to Arlington, the National Cemetery. And here's John giving that salute his father taught him at his funeral. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about here is the investigation into JFK's murder. Because again, like I said, Oswald was never allowed to stand trial. He was killed before that happened. So there was a lot of questions that weren't answered. And so President Johnson creates the Warren Commission. And the entire purpose of the Warren Commission is to investigate the assassination of JFK. Now, after 10 months, they spend almost a year investigating this, the Warren Report states that both Lee Harvey Oswald and his killer, Jack Ruby, acted alone. There was no conspiracy to assassinate JFK. There were a lot of conspiracy theories, and you'll still find conspiracy theories today about the Kennedy murder, because there was just so many questions. Again, why would Lee Harvey Oswald kill him? You know, we don't know, because he was killed by Jack Ruby. Well, why would Jack Ruby kill Oswald? And so there's a lot of questions here about what happened, and that's what the Warren Report was meant to answer.